of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. James 1. Please stand and sing with us.
Thank you. life when I literally cried out to Jesus. And how no matter what I was going through or where I'd been or where I was going, he always had an answer. He always provided. Hear the word, but as James 1:22 says, don't just merely hear it, but go and do it. That we can be a part of your great commission, that we can lead everyone to find and follow Jesus. Father, we thank you so much for the blood of Jesus on the cross that washes us clean, for the sacrifice made that he didn't have to make, that he chose to make through your love and through his love for us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Good to see you all. Welcome home. If you don't know, our mission as a church is to, as Lance said, lead everyone to find and follow Jesus. And there's no better example of that than what went on yesterday as we represented this church to the community and had folks out at the street fair trying to bring others to know the goodness of Jesus and what it means to be his follower. If you are a first-time guest here with us this morning, we are thankful to have you. Thank you so much for coming and checking us out. We would ask that you stick around for a little while and get to know us and let us get to know you and just see how we can chase after Jesus together, follow him alongside one another. And so a couple of weeks ago, if you didn't know, we had a movie night here at the church. And as part of that movie night here at the building, the church of the people, but you get me. We had a great turnout for that. Had a bunch of families, a bunch of kids that got to watch a movie. But before we came in to watch the movie, we did a little activity outside. And you probably walked across it a few times, but we took some sidewalk chalk and gave it out to the different kids and families. And we asked them to draw something that represented their family. And it was really cool to see all of the different representations that we got in that picture. All the different ways that people represented their families with the things that they drew. And some of the folks were prompted to draw their moms and dads and their siblings. Others were prompted to draw stuffed animals because they have a whole bunch of stuffed animals. That would be the Burchettes. Some of them drew a family crest. Some of them drew the church logo because they said, hey, the church is about being a family. And so they were just really cool to see all of the different conceptualizations of this word family and the minds of young ones who were drawing these things that went along with that. So this morning, what I want you to do, if you are a young one and you are here, is listen for the word family, right? Listen for that word as we worship today and as we finish out this sermon series on marriage. Many of you guys may know a TV family that was from the 1950s. I would assume that almost everyone knows this picture here of Leave It to Beaver. Have you guys seen that before? This was a program that was supposed to depict the stereotypical 1950s family. And the program, literally, the folks that were in this program had a white picket fence out front. Like, they couldn't have been any more stereotypical of what a 1950s family was supposed to look like in America at that time. And many of you guys might know that the father's name was Ward, right? Yeah, Ward Cleaver. And Ward was his namesake. He was an authoritarian, very steady figure. He was a solid dad, always dressed to the nines in a business suit almost all the time. And he was a very brimming with wisdom kind of dad, right? He would take time to explain things and life lessons to his boys. And the mother, whose name was June. Cleaver. She was always positive, very supportive, again, very put together. She always had on really spectacular clothing, even though she was cleaning or cooking or spending time with her boys. She was always there and just incredibly steady. And Ward and June, they had these two boys, Wally, and then the namesake of the program, the Beaver, right? And these two were well-mannered boys. Even at the times when they were at each other's throats, they would never go past calling each other a knucklehead, right? Like, that was as bad as it got for those boys because they were just the examples of what young boys were supposed to be like in the 1950s. And so as we look at that depiction of Leave It to Beaver, there are some not-so-subtle messages that are getting across to those who would watch the program. Messages like good behavior gets a reward. Negative behavior gets a punishment, right? And we would see that parents are supposed to be role models for their kids, and they're supposed to make them into good behaving citizens, good moral character citizens in America. And that was the kind of message of that program, and that a good family and a good marriage, that was the good life. That was what life was all about. Be like the Cleavers, that's where you will find true happiness. The only problem with that is that if you were anything like me, you didn't grow up in the Cleaver home, right? I didn't grow up with two parents in the household. I didn't grow up with siblings who only called me ever a knucklehead, right? I grew up with very different situation surroundings than the Cleaver family. It was nothing like that. And folks, as we look through the Bible, we don't find Leave It to Beaver. We find over and over and over the people who are depicted in Scripture are far from ideal in their behavior. They're far from ideal in showing us what marriage and what family truly look like. The Bible is very honest in the way that it shows us a picture of these people and the way that they live. The Bible puts forward marriage and family as beautiful things, God's good, gracious gifts to us. And yet, it shows us that so many times, almost universally, people miss the mark in the ideals of what that is supposed to look like. It shows us the pain and the difficulty and the brokenness that are just evident that we exist in a fallen world. That things aren't like they are ideally supposed to be. That we live in a very different surrounding and circumstance than what we find in those ideal depictions. We've been talking about love and about romance and about marriage over these last 4 weeks. And we've been just kind of discussing these things and the way that these things have been kind of corrupted by the society that we live in, because it is a fallen society. It is a sin-filled society all around us. And what we've been laying out is God's beautiful design for what marriage and for what love and for what romance are supposed to look like. However, what I've come to say to you today is this, that the purpose of each and every person in this room is not to find love or romance or marriage. The purpose of each and every one of us, your purpose and my purpose, is to find a Savior. One who delivers us from all of those ideals that we miss, all of those requirements of the law that we fall short of. We are made to find our Creator through the Savior who came and gave his life in our place for our sins. Whether you have well-behaved kids or your kids are, as Lance talked about in our Sunday school this morning, a hot mess, right? Whether you have the ideal marriage, which I don't believe that anyone here does, but if you do, great. Or your marriage is holding together by shoestrings and super glue. Listen, your purpose is to find your Savior, and he will give meaning to all of those things of love and of marriage and of romance. We have a God-shaped hole in each and every one of us that only Jesus can fill. And the creation of this world was to find that Jesus is the only answer for all of the ills that we have. And so this morning, what I want to do is look at the way that God used one dysfunctional family to redeem the world. One family that was a hot mess, that knew that they needed a Savior, and he used them to be a blessing to the entire world, that they would redeem the world through this one family and the way that God used them. And so let's pray, and then we will open up God's word this morning. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the way that you created us. For despite the fact that we run in our own way and we follow our own path so often, Father, that you are there to usher us back to where we need to be. Father, that through your word we see what it means for you to give yourself in our place so that we can have a fellowship with you, a right relationship with the one who created us to be his children. And so, Lord, as we come to you this morning, looking into your word and seeing the way that you ushered this broken family through history and used them to redeem the world, we just ask you to help us to see ourselves in this story, to see ourselves as those who are needing of a redeemer, those who are needing of a deliverer, to see those who are needy for your hand in our lives. And so, Lord, as we open up your word this morning, we ask you to transform us from within so that we might represent you to the people who are around us in our lives. We love you and we thank you most of all for Jesus. It's in his name we pray. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. If you have a Bible with you, grab that. Open up your Bible. We're going to be in Genesis chapter 29. If you don't have a Bible, there should be some in the chairs there near you. In Genesis 29, we are actually jumping one generation forward from where we were a week ago. Last week, we looked at Isaac and Rebecca and their marriage, their betrothal, the process from which they became husband and wife. This week, we are looking at their kids, two twin boys named Jacob and Esau. Mostly, we're going to look at Jacob, but Esau was there too. And Only they weren't born in the Jacob and Esau order, right? If you know anything about Scripture, you know that actually it was Esau who was the firstborn. He was the one who came out first, and with Jacob holding on to his heel, right? And that's where Jacob's name actually comes from. It means heel grasper. It is this picture of who Jacob was right at his birth, holding on to the heel of his brother Esau coming out of his mother's womb. And Jacob, he lived up to that name. He was a heel grasper at all points in time. He was constantly on his brother's tail. He from the very start was plotting and scheming and scraping as a deceiver and a liar all along the path that he wanted to get by his brother Esau, because Esau was the firstborn. And in Jewish society, the firstborn was a big deal. Esau was big, and he was rugged, and he was skillful as a hunter. And his father took a liking to him, and he was the favorite son of Isaac. He loved Esau. Whereas Jacob, on the other hand, was more of a mama's boy. He was a homebody. He liked to stay around the tents and the camp, and he was comfortable right there. And so he ends up having a really close relationship with his mother, Rebekah. And later we will see that this playing of favorites between Isaac and Rebekah, it makes its way into Jacob's family, and it actually causes a whole lot of problems in the relationships that he has with his own sons. And it causes a whole lot of problems with those sons and the way they relate to one another, because playing favorites is not a good way to go. Now back to Rebekah's pregnancy for just a minute. The Lord, as she's pregnant with these two boys, that she feels like are warring within her. She says the pregnancy feels like these two boys are just fighting with each other in her womb. And there's a war going on inside of her. And as she describes this, the Lord actually gives her this revelation through a vision where he tells her that the older of those two boys is going to serve the younger. That Jacob is actually going to be the child of promise. And so maybe that's part of the reason why she has such a liking to Jacob, why she favors him so much. And this idea of the older brother serving the younger was, again, completely against Jewish culture and really all of the culture at that time. The firstborn was the one who got priority. The firstborn was the one who received the birthright. Everything would pass on to him, all of the responsibility and all of the duty and everything would pass on to him when the patriarch died. And he would get a double share of all the inheritance as it was brought together. And so that was kind of the picture of this idea of the firstborn. Only when Isaac is nearing death, Rebekah has a thought in her head. Hey, Isaac is going to bless Esau, and that's not the one who God told me was supposed to be the promised child. So I'm going to devise a scheme of my own, and I'm going to go and tell Jacob, hey, you should pretend to be your brother, and that way you can have the blessing that Isaac is about to give. And so she gives him this plot, devises up a scheme in which Jacob can make himself feel and smell like Esau. And while Esau is out trying to get all of the material for his father's great meal of the game that he loves the best, she takes Jacob and she says, hey, you're going to pretend like you're Esau, and you're going to come with this stew that he loves, and it's going to be a way for you to take the blessing. And Isaac blesses Jacob, and he says, you will lord over your brothers. You may make the sons of your mother bow down to you. And so all of a sudden, now Jacob has taken the blessing that belongs to Esau. And I know that's all quite a bit of backstory to get to where we're going to be in Genesis 29, but it's important and it's necessary for us to understand just all of the complexities of this family before we jump into it. Esau, he returns from this hunt, and he finds that his dad has blessed his brother, and he is enraged. He says, my brother will not live. I will kill him. And so Rebekah tells Jacob, you've got to go. You've got to go away from here. You're going to go back to my people in Padan Aram, where I came from, to my family, and you're going to stay there. And you'll get married, and you'll just stay there until your brother's anger subsides, and this all passes over, and everything is fine. And then you can come back. And so that's kind of where we pick up this story in Genesis chapter 29, starting in verse 9. It says, while he was still talking with them, Jacob is there at a well that belongs to Rebekah's family. Her brother Laban is kind of the patriarch at this point. and he goes to this well and he meets some other people. And as he's talking to them, it says Rachel came up with her father's sheep, for she was a shepherd. When Jacob saw Rachel, the daughter of his uncle Laban, Laban's sheep, he went over and rolled away the stone from the mouth of the well and watered his uncle's sheep. Then he kissed Rachel and began to weep. I'm not sure that's the first impression I would want to make, is a pat on the cheek and a starting a loud weeping, but you know, that's that to each their own, I guess. Verse 12, he told Rachel that he was a relative of her father and the son of Rebekah. So she ran and told her father. As Laban heard the news about Jacob and his sister's son, he hurried to meet him. He embraced him and kissed him and brought him to his home. And there Jacob told him all these things. And Laban said to him, "You are my own flesh and blood." And so Jacob has now found a home. He's going to stay with his uncle and his uncle's family for the next better part of 2 decades, 20 years. He's going to be there in Padan Aram. Continuing, after Jacob had stayed with him for a whole month, Laban said to him, "Just because you are a relative of mine, should you work for me for nothing? Tell me what your wages should be." So that seems like a pretty stand-up thing to do, right? Like, you've been here, you've been working, you're working hard for me, I would like to pay you. Let's negotiate some sort of contract, right? Seems like a stand-up thing for Laban to do. How can I pay you? What should your wage be? Verse 16, now Laban had two daughters. The name of the older was Leah, the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah had weak eyes, but Rachel had a lovely figure and was beautiful. That sounds like the beginning of like a good Harlequin romance novel, doesn't it? Like, one man, two sisters, how will this all go? He's going to find out. And the description that we get here of these two sisters is that one has weak eyes. Now, that is a euphemism for being not so attractive. In that culture and in that time, back in the BC era, a lot of times women would wear a veil or a covering and you wouldn't see much except for their eyes. And so to have weak eyes was, again, this euphemism of being kind of a little unattractive, not so attractive. And in comparison to her younger sister, Rachel, who it says was beautiful and had a lovely figure, right? And so you could use a different euphemism to talk about Rachel. She was, as we would call, a 10, right? Like, she was beautiful. And so completely unrelated to that, right? I'm sure the next verse says, Jacob was in love with Rachel, right? The beautiful one. That's the one he fell in love with. Coincidentally. And said, "I will work for you for 7 years in return for your younger daughter, Rachel." And this is one of the few places in Scripture that we ever see the mention of love, then marriage. Almost always it goes the opposite way in Scripture, that it's marriage and then love. That they married each other and then they loved each other. And actually there is an ancient Jewish saying that goes like this. It says, if you put a hot soup into a bowl, it grows cold. But if you take cold soup and put it on the fire, it grows hot. Right? And this is supposed to be an illustration of the fact that if you marry for passion, those passions grow cold. But if you marry, you will find love. And that's kind of the idea there. That's almost always the way that Jewish people would look at this and think about this. But we get a very different picture here when it comes to Jacob. He has this overwhelming love. And what the love that's being talked about there is more of an eros love than it is like a agape love, right? We're looking at a love that is romantic love, that is a passion love, not a well thought out, I've chosen to love this person kind of love. Jacob is working in a different direction, and he makes this outlandish bride price for Rachel to her father Laban. He says, I will work for you for 7 years. Now, what we can find out from history and archaeology about bride prices was that they were customary. That when you wanted to marry a woman, you would come and you would offer a bride price to her father, and that was kind of your way of asking for her hand in marriage, and that you had the means to take care of her. And so in this picture, we see Jacob doing just that, but at that time, the bride price was about 30 shekels. And 1.5 shekels per month was the average cost of a laborer. And so if you do the math there, what Jacob is offering his uncle Laban is about twice what the bride price would be in his service to Laban for these 7 years. He's not negotiating, right? He's saying, hey, listen, I'm going to make you an offer you can't refuse, right? I'm going to make sure that this woman is mine. I want her, and I'm going to make sure that I pay every dime that I have. He doesn't have a whole lot of money because he's come from running from his brother, but he's going to serve his uncle for these 7 years so that he can have Rachel as his own. Verse 19, Laban said, it's better that I give her to you than some other man. Stay here with me. And so Jacob served 7 years to get Rachel, but they seemed like only a few days because of his love for her. Men, if you want to get in the good graces of your wife this week, just look at her deep in her eyes and say, these last 7 years have seemed like just a few days to me because of my deep affection, my love for you. Right? That's a good line. That will work. That'll preach in your marriage. Hey, if you're not married, remember that one, because in your seventh year anniversary, that'd be a good one to just bring out then. You can go back to scripture and get one for you. He's saying, listen, this time has gone by. If you've ever had something you're anticipating, doesn't it always seem like it goes the opposite direction? Like if you're waiting for something to happen, if you've been anticipating something really strongly, it seems like it'll never get here. Takes forever for it to come. He's saying, listen, I love her so much that it seems like this 7 years is just flown by. And so it's completely the other direction. Time flies by for Jacob. And then in verse 21, then Jacob said to Laban, give me my wife. My time is complete and I want to be with her. I'm gonna edit that for the young ears. But the actual phrase that he uses there actually is a very strong phrase of what he wishes out of this whole situation. Actually, a Jewish scholar named Robert Alter, he says that this verse has actually been a problem for rabbinical commentators all through history because it is utterly out of character and beyond custom and discretion for a man to say that to a father. It is just outside of the bounds of what you would ever say. And I think this is the author's way, as he writes this story about what Jacob says here, of him saying that Jacob is just full of passion for this woman. He's seeing red. I mean, it's all love for him, and he's full go. He wants to have what he has worked for, and he's worked for Rachel. I don't want to psychoanalyze Jacob, but I'm going to do a little bit of that. I'm not qualified to, so just take that with a grain of salt. But Jacob is looking at Rachel, and I think that he is seeing everything that he has ever wanted in this woman. Almost as if she's a prized possession. He has come from a situation where he has always been the younger brother. And now that he's stolen his brother's birthright, he's been forced out of that place. Now he's in a foreign land among foreign people, and he's there. And man, he's been looking forward these whole 7 years to this moment when he will finally have what he thinks is going to bring him all of the satisfaction of life. All of the goodness of everything that God has promised in marriage is going to be encapsulated in this one woman, Rachel. And when he has her, oh boy, everything's going to go well. That everything will be fixed. He will have that hole within him filled with having Rachel by his side. Verse 22, so Laban brought together all the people of the place and gave a feast. And when evening came, he took his daughter, Leah, and brought her to Jacob. Now remember, this is 2,000 years B.C. This is well before there were lights, right? And so under the cover of darkness at night, Laban brings one daughter instead of the other daughter to Jacob. He has decided that this is the way that he is going to marry off Leah. He's going to bring her to him. And this is before they had big wedding ceremonies where you stood, you know, right in front of each other and you said the vows to each other. Like the actual consummation process was the ceremony at that time. That when you came together in the tent, that was the marriage. That's when it all started. And so under the cloak of darkness, and when Jacob has not been able to see what's going on, Laban brings Leah and he places her in the tent, in the place of Rachel. Verse 25. When morning came, there was Leah. Jacob wakes up and he's anticipating on the pillow next to him the face of this beautiful, lovely Rachel, and instead he gets weak eyes, right? He gets Leah. And so Jacob said to Laban, "What is this you have done to me?" He's angry, right? He's disappointed with the situation. He's angry about the situation. He can't believe it. He said, "What is this you have done to me? I served you for Rachel, didn't I? Why have you deceived me?" And I bet, just as those words left Jacob's lips, he remembered someone else saying those same things to him. He remembered that Isaac, when he had covered himself with lambskin so his hair would feel like his brother Esau's, and he had made himself smell like Esau to fool his dad who had bad eyesight. I bet he remembers that Isaac's words were, "Why have you deceived me?" And he says that to Laban. He says, Why have you deceived me? Here's a guy who will do anything. Here's a guy who was at the mercy of this father. He didn't negotiate a bride price. He just threw out this outlandish number to have this girl. And I think Laban saw that his hook was set for this guy to do whatever it was that he wanted him to do. And all of a sudden, the con man has become the con. The con man, the deceiver, Jacob, he has become the one who is deceived by Laban. And almost like one of those scenes in Ocean's 11 when they do like that music montage and they show you how everything played out for everything to be perfectly in set. I think we can see this moment back in verse 19. You see, as Jacob said, "I will serve you 7 years for your younger daughter, Rachel." What did Laban say? He didn't say, "Yes, agreed. I will give you Rachel for 7 years. We have made a contract." That's not what he said. He said, "It's better for you to have her than some other man. It's better that I give her to you than someone else." He didn't say yes, but Jacob heard yes because yes was what Jacob wanted to hear. And so he believed he was working these 7 years to have Rachel, which again is the implication that Laban gave, but he never said that was exactly what was going to happen. And actually, Laban is going to explain his actions this way. He says, "It's not our custom here to give the younger daughter in marriage before the older one." That's not our custom. Now, if Jacob didn't know what was going on before now, he knows now. You see, as he had explained all of this to Laban, Laban is almost teaching him the lesson that he had passed off onto his father. And in a disguise, without vision, Isaac had given that blessing to Jacob, thinking that he was one when he was really the other. And now Laban, under a disguise of darkness, without vision, has passed off the older sister as the younger. And he thought he was getting one person, but he got another. He was tricked by his own trick. The con man has fallen for his own gambit. And now Laban continues. He says, "Finish this daughter's bridal week. Then I will give you the younger one also in return for another 7 years of work." And Jacob did so. He finished his week with Leah. And Laban gave him his daughter Rachel to be his wife. Now, in all of this, it's very easy to forget that Jacob is not the only victim. Right? You have another sister who's involved here, Leah. Man, that's got to be disastrous. And she's become the pawn in this scheme to get rid of her. Like he's unloading her on Jacob. That's got to do wonders for her confidence, for how she feels about herself, for her identity. Jumping down to verse 30, Jacob, his love for Rachel was greater than his love for Leah. And he worked for Laban another 7 years, and now Leah is married to a man who doesn't love her like he loves her sister, who didn't want her and now has her. Verse 31, the Lord saw that Leah was not loved. He enabled her to deceive, but Rachel remained childless. We can see here kind of the juxtaposition of this hard world that Leah is in and God's loving hand on her life. The way that he reaches out to her when she feels unloved and unwanted and overlooked and overshadowed by her younger sister. Leah became pregnant, gave birth to a son. She named him Reuben, which means seen. For she said, "It is because the Lord has seen my misery, surely my husband will love me now." Leah is suffering from that same affliction that Jacob was. She's thinking that if she can just find Jacob's affection, if Jacob would see her and he would love her the way he loves her sister, that everything would be right in her life, that she would have the satisfaction that she's reaching for. She would have the goodness of God and on her, because now Jacob has turned his affections toward her instead of her sister, Rachel. You see, Leah has always been the ugly duckling to her beautiful, lovely in figure sister, Rachel. She's been ignored, and she's been unwanted, and she's been looked through, and she's grown up in the shadow of her younger sister. And so Laban has passed her off in this manner. And now, finally, she's given Jacob a firstborn son. He's got to see that. He's got to appreciate that. He's got to love her for that. And she's doing the same thing that Jacob was doing in fawning over Rachel for all of those 7 years leading up to what he thought was a marriage to Rachel. And she's putting Jacob in that same spot of controlling who her identity is, who her confidence and everything that she knows about herself. She wants to be known and to be valued and to be loved by her husband, and she's not finding that. And you see it every time she names a son from that point on. She named her first one Reuben because she said, the Lord has seen him. I want Jacob to see me. Right? Now listen, she conceived again. And when she gave birth to a son, she said, "Because the Lord has heard I am not loved, he gave me this one too." And she named him Simeon, which means hurt. And again, she conceived, and when she gave birth to a son, she said, "Now at last my husband will become attached to me, because I have borne him 3 sons. And so she named him Levi, which means attached. And she conceived again, and she gave birth to a son, and said, "This time I will praise the Lord." And so she named him Judah, which means praise. And she stopped having children. See, for years, Leah had been searching for fulfillment and searching for satisfaction in this marriage and coming up empty. She's wanting to be seen. She's wanting to be heard. She's wanting to have attachment, to be embraced by her husband, and yet she's finding none of that. But finally, she gives up on being seen and heard and attached to Jacob, and she sees all of that in being seen, being known, being valued, being loved by God. And she says, "I'm going to praise him. I'm going to worry about him. And this time I will praise the Lord." And of course, we all know that the one that she names Judah, praise, Jesus is the Lion of the tribe of Judah, right? This is the messianic line. This is the one who everything's going to come from. This is the one that Jacob is later going to bless and say, this is the one who gets the blessing. And so David and Solomon and Hezekiah and Josiah and Jesus come from the line of Judah. It's not Rachel, Jacob's loved wife, who gets to be the wife of blessing and the wife of the Messiah. But it's the God-loved wife, Leah. When we get down to the brass tacks of what this historical narrative is giving us, it is clear that, as we said in the very beginning, that our purpose, just like Leah's purpose, is not to find love or romance or marriage. It is to find a Savior. It is to find someone who's actually worthy of redeeming us, someone who will actually deliver all of the promises that we think we're going to find somewhere else. It is one of those pictures that only God can provide redemption and salvation and deliverance. I want to go back to verse 25 this morning. And in that famous quote, "When the morning came,
there was there.
It certainly wasn't Lita's fault that she was there. And your heart has to go out to her for just the situation that she's been placed into. And at the same time, the position that Jacob is in there, an Old Testament scholar by the name of Derek Kidner, he says this. He says, this moment, the moment where Jacob wakes up next to Leah, is a snapshot of the disillusionment man has experienced from Eden onward. It is a clear picture of when you put all of your hope in someone or something outside of Jesus, that there is a sadness that when you wake up the morning that you have that thing and you realize it's real. It's not what you thought it was. It's not going to deliver everything that you had ever hoped for. It's not going to deliver everything that you've always wanted. It's real. And an early church leader named Augustine, he made this point by saying to God, our hearts will always be restless until they find their rest in you. That is the human condition, that we are restless until we find our rest in God. That's what we see in the picture of Leah. She is restless with her marriage until she finds her rest in who God is and her identity as someone loved by God. When we place something out in front of us and we say, this thing will make me happy, this relationship, this possession, this car, this house, this job, this situation, that's where I'm going to find all of the things that I've been looking for throughout my entire life. It's going to be when I have that. Guess what? When you get that job, when you get that career, when you get that degree, when you get that relationship, whatever it is that you place out in front of yourself, in the morning, it's clear. It is a disappointment from what you thought it would be. Unless, like Leah, you find your enjoyment in God. Unless you could say, come what may, I'm going to praise God. That He has given me a true Savior. He's given me a real Redeemer. He has delivered me from all of life's disappointments, even when those disappointments are my own creation. That He can actually deliver on only what He can provide, and I won't find that anywhere else. And so Jacob's family and his situation, and it was ugly, it was disastrous, and it's dysfunctional. And if you read through the next two chapters here of Genesis 30 and 31, you just see, like, man, it is a train wreck. It is something out of soap operas, daytime TV, like reality shows. I mean, it's gross. Just everything that goes on, deception everywhere, backbiting and fighting and arguing and running away and dealing with hurt feelings. And the whole thing is just very, very ugly. It is a hot mess. That's always the story when we look for salvation in something that is outside of God's provision. You see, the story of the Bible isn't about people who save themselves. It's about a God who becomes a person in order to save people from themselves and for himself. He even does this through Jacob's dysfunctional family. God uses this very vehicle of this hot mess to be the vehicle that he will bring about redemption. From the line of Judah will come Jesus. And through that succession of people who missed the mark all the way down, we find Jesus, the one who actually hit the mark in every aspect of life. The one who lived perfectly in our place. And who died sacrificially for our sins. And who loved us so much that he willingly went to the cross to purchase us for our Father so that we can have perfect relationship to him. And even in the midst of families that look not idyllic, like the Cleavers, God is at work, redeeming and delivering and saving, even here still today. We serve a God who doesn't say to strong people, by your strength and by your virtue, you can earn your way to heaven. We serve a God who humbles himself and fulfills all the virtuous requirements for us and says to you, it's through me that you will find everything that you're looking for. If you are here this morning and you feel like you need a Savior, if you are here this morning and you feel like nothing less than the sacrifice of the Son of God could save you, could cleanse you, could cover your sins, good news, He's done it. He's given Himself in your place for your sins so that you can call Him Abba, Father, Daddy. God chooses the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chooses the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chooses the lowly things of the world, the despised things, the things that are not, to nullify the things that are, so that no one can boast before Him. Hallelujah! What a Savior. Amen? Our Father and our God, we thank You this morning that You are so good. Lord, that outside of You, there is no salvation. Father, there is nothing that's going to deliver in our lives and is going to bring us fulfillment and satisfaction and enjoyment and the goodness that only You can give. But Father, knowing that better than we do, You gave us Jesus. You came and lived that perfect life that we don't. You gave Yourself in our place for our sins on the cross. And You didn't stay dead. 3 days later, You triumphantly overcame sin, death, and the devil, bringing Jesus back to life. And Father, for each and every one of us in this room who have placed our faith in Your Son, we know that resurrection actually guarantees ours. That Your Holy Spirit inside of us is a deposit, a down payment on a salvation that will go on for eternity in heaven. Lord, help us to dwell in that today. To revel in who we are, not because we are perfect in our roles as husbands and fathers and mothers and wives, but because we revel in our role as children of God through Your Son, Jesus. Lord, we love You and we thank You for who Jesus is, for what He has done for each and every one of us. We just lift up these prayers to You today, knowing that You are so, so good. We love You and thank You for all of these things. In the mighty name of Jesus, and all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Will you stand with me and have a song of reflection and response? A moment where we can again remember what it is that Jesus has done for each and every one of us. I am so thankful for people who, despite all of our flaws, all of our shortcomings, reflect Jesus and the fact that we trust Him over our own goodness. And so as we come this morning, if you are here and you have never accepted the gift of salvation comes through Jesus, would you come forward? And just, I'm going to be right down here in the front. I would love to have a conversation on what that next step looks like for you. Maybe you're right where you are this morning and you just need to rejoice in what Jesus has done for you. You've been reminded of all the goodness of God. Sing these words out this morning and mean them like you're saying them for the first time. Sing these things out to God in praise and adoration for the One who's given Himself in your place for your sins. Let's sing.
Thank you.
Jesus asks us when we come together and take a seat to remember him through the emblems of the wine and the bread. At this time, Brother Charles is going to bring us into that.
Do you think Jacob ever felt remorse in the story of his man? Did he ever wake up and feel guilty? Well, my meditation this morning is going to be on guilt. Because it's God's grace, not our guilt. This morning I want to remind us that Jesus gave us the Lord's Supper so we might be able to be refreshed in him. Too often we have a view of the Lord's Supper that is overly self-reflective and guilt-driven. A lot of times we think that it's primarily about what I need to fix. I need to remember and confess every single sin I've ever committed this week. I need to feel guilty for how far I fall short. We make the Lord's Supper more about our sin instead of Jesus and his grace. Don't get me wrong, the Bible says communion is a privilege for all his children walking with him. If you're a believer, if you know you're in a place of willful disobedience, you need to take the time before taking this meal. For most of us following Christ this morning, the reality is we come in here on Sunday morning fully aware of how sinful and undeserving we are. We bring our burdens and our pains here, and we need God to give us refreshing with his grace. We bring our doubt and fears into this room, and we need God to grant us assurance. We come aware of our sins and how messy we are, and we need a gospel of free grace applied in our hearts. That's exactly why God gave us this Lord's Supper. It isn't what we do once we've gotten things right on our end. We do it believing God makes it right through the body and blood of Jesus. Yes, this is the time we confess our sins, but instead of trying to clean ourselves up or staying in a place of guilt right there in our seats, we come to Jesus, the Lord's Supper, and the act of faith where he says he is the answer and alone he is what we need. The Lord's Supper is not about our worthiness, our fitness to be about the worthiness of Jesus and how amazing his grace is makes us fit to sit at God's table. As you eat and drink this morning, do so in awareness that Jesus is still today, in this very moment, a sufficient Savior. For all of our sins, he offers us the grace to help in any situation we're up against. So as we take these physical objects this morning, the bread and the wine, may God use a powerful taste of the forgiveness and the fulfillment of Jesus for us. This supper is an invitation not for those who've got things under control and are great people. It is an invitation for the sinful and the weak. We are Christians in need of Christ's grace. So Jesus invites us this morning to come to the Lord's Supper. All who are thirsty, come. All who are weak and wounded, come. All who are aware of their sin and need grace, he says, come. So as you chew the bread, remember this morning that in fact it was Christ's body that was crushed under wrath so that you might have everything in grace. And as you drink that juice this morning, rejoice that Jesus' blood was paid for our unrighteousness and purchased with redemption. Will you pray with me? Our Father and God, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for all he has done. Your grace is enough for us today. I pray that the Holy Spirit will continue to work through us. As our hearts are changed, we have the same desires that you have for us, Lord. Father, remove our thoughts of guilt and turn them to the desires and thoughts of grace. Thank you for being such a loving and caring Father. I thank you most of all for Jesus and that sacrifice that he made for all. And it's in his holy and precious name I pray. Amen.
Okay, just a few announcements. Opportunity to give, you can put in the basket, we got Tively or Venmo. QR codes are up there or out by the front. If you have a prayer request that needs to be prayed, there's cards in the back of the chairs or QR code, or go on to the website that you can leave it there, put private or public, and we'll publish it formally to your plans. Next one will be Camp McComey, 9th through 12th grade is this week. On Thursday, we have the responsibility to provide workers to help serve the evening meal and to provide the dessert. I know Karina and I will be going out there, but if you have a dessert that you want to be taken out there, just let Karina know and we'll come by and get them picked up. And we need to be out there at 3 o'clock to serve that evening meal. Our family, June family meal is next Sunday, following right after the service. We'll just meet out there in the fellowship hall for that. Independence Day, we're going to put a float into the parade. The plan is to meet here on Wednesday night to decorate the float if it's weather cooperates. If not, we'll go to Cardinal Drive like we have the last couple years. And then the last one is the Right Now Media. If you don't have a sign up for that, see Sean. It's a free platform that we as the church sponsors. It's great for some Bible studies or just a whole lot of information there. If you're not part of it, see Sean and he'll get you registered for it. I'll close in prayer and then we'll be dismissed. Dear Lord, our Heavenly Father, we just praise you for another day to be in your house. Thank you for the message. I just pray for each marriage here and for our walks of life. I just pray that you'll continue to bless us, make our marriages great, that we can be your shining light as we go out in this world, that people will be able to see you. I just thank you for another day and thank you for what your son did. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.